Hi, in this Affinity Publisher tutorial, we're going to look at the Shape tool. It's over here on the left toolbar, and it may have any one of a number of icons depending on what the last shape you used was. So it'll probably default for you to the rectangle tool. But as you can see, when you click on this little arrow in the corner, you get a whole flyout menu of other shapes that you can use. In this first video, I'm going to just talk about the rectangle tool. And then I'm going to do a separate video that goes through some of these other tools. So let's get started. So I'm on the rectangle tool, and I'm just going to click, hold the left mouse button, and drag and let go. So let's take a look at some of the options we have. We have our contextual toolbar up here, and the first option we have is fill. So if we click that, we get our color wheel, and we can change the fill color. So let's make it that color. And then right next to that, I can click the stroke color, and we could make that, let's say, navy blue or something like that. And you're not seeing it much right now because, first of all, it still has the selection bounding box around it. And second of all, this next option here, the stroke weight, is only at 0.2. So let's thicken that up by dragging the slider up. You can also just click in this box and put whatever you want as the stroke weight. While we're in the strokes, you can also change what the end of the line looks like. So here it's a rounded end. It's not going to look like there's much happening here when I click through these because of this particular type of shape. So we also have how it looks in the joints. You can see this kind of shaved off the corner, and this made it a completely square corner instead of having a rounded end here. And then also the stroke is currently in the center. So where we see the bounding box, and let's just zoom way in on that. Where we see the bounding box, this little blue line, that's where the stroke is right now. And so if we change that, we can make the stroke be on the outside of it, and we can make the stroke line be on the inside of it. And it will default to the middle there. An important one to know is scale with object. And so what this means is when you make this smaller, it's going to proportionally make that stroke line smaller along with it. So you can see how this kind of scaled. And if I turn that off and I resize it, then you can see that now I've got a very thick stroke down here compared to the fill. So scale with object is a good thing to have checkmarked on if you might want to resize your objects. And then next door, we've got some other options here. I'm going to start with probably the first most useful, and that would be the corner edges. So that's over here. And if you click on this little drop down, right now it's just coming to a square corner. I can also click rounded, and you can see that rounded the corners on all four sides. And then I can adjust how much it's rounded with my little slider here next to it. I can adjust the percentage. We also have straight, concave, and cutout. With any of these, you'll see a red dot in most of the shapes, and you can just grab that red dot, and just by holding the left mouse button and kind of moving your mouse around, you can change the proportions there. Let's go back to the rounded edges. Now, let's say that I want some of my edges to be rounded, but not all of them. So that is this feature over here, single radius. And right now it's clicked on, which means for everything that I click on here, it's going to affect all four corners equally. If I turn this off, now you can see this area changed to be top right, bottom left, bottom right, and then top left over here. So now I can change each one of these to be something different. Now, I don't know why I would want to do that. Maybe to make it into a puzzle piece, that would be interesting. And then each one of these also can have its amount controlled separately. You'll also see that now each of these has its own red dot that I can manipulate like that. like that. So you can create all sorts of shapes with this. Okay, so let's undo some of that. In fact, let's just get rid of our shape altogether and draw a new one out. And let's look at some of the other options we have. So we've looked at fill, stroke. One more thing about stroke is when you click on the stroke color, you have the little circle with the red line, which will take your stroke off. You can do the same thing with the fill. If you want just an outlined box with no fill, you can just click on the fill and find this white circle with the red line. You can also access that from the stroke here with the style, and it's got an X here, and you can take the stroke off that way as well. And you can also make it a dotted stroke. All right, so let's look at some of our other options here when we have our shape selected. So first is enable transform origin. So before I turn that on, let's take a look at what happens when we rotate. Now look in the center of this rectangle, you have what looks like an angle, and you can actually see an R with a number telling you your rotation angle as you move this around. That is our origin. We are spinning this shape around that origin. So now let's enable transform origin, and you'll see in the middle, it's pretty hard to see. I need to not zoom in too much or we won't be able to see the effect. But now we've got a little blue circle here, and I can drag that where I want. So let's drag that down to the bottom here. Zoom out a tiny bit. Now when I spin, it's rotating around that point instead of rotating around the center of the shape. So when this is on, then your origin can be somewhere else. All right, next we have hide selection while dragging. So what hide selection while dragging does is you'll see I've got a bounding box. Let's turn it off. And it's selected my shape because it's got this box around it. And when I move it around, I still see these bounding box lines and all my little handles. When I turn this on, as soon as I pick it up and move it with the mouse, that selection goes away. So that could be handy. Sometimes when you're designing, this actually gets in your way of seeing exactly how you're lining something up or what your result might look like. So this allows you to move it without seeing those bounding boxes. Right next door to it, we have show alignment handles. Now, this is kind of a cool one in that when you have your snapping on and you move something around, you get these little guides. So now I've got my center guides. So I can move this handle over and it's going to center my shape to wherever I move that. And I can grab these two little triangles, move them, and it's going to line up my shape to be centered along wherever I place that line. So where this could be handy, I'm a little bit crooked right now, but let's just say we had a grid. So let's do view show grid. And I could take these handles and pick any one of my grid lines and line them up. And it's going to help me line things up really nicely to a grid. So that is this option here called show alignment handles. This one, transform objects separately, is another kind of little known feature. So let's make a copy and then I'm going to select both of them. And when I rotate, you'll see that my origin is somewhere in between my shapes. It's grabbing both of them. And you can see how I rotate around here. Now, when I have that enabled, this one here, which is transform objects separately, and now I select both of them. Now when I rotate, they each rotate individually around their own origins instead of their collective origins. So that can be handy if you've got multiple objects and you want to rotate all of them the same amount. All right, so next one that we've got is our alignment tools, which we'll cover the alignment tools in a separate video, but as you can click through them, you can see it's aligning to the top, aligning to the bottom, centering it. And so these are ways to just align your different objects. And then finally, we've got convert to curves. So when I do that, I no longer have a shape. Now I have individual nodes, similar to how we talked about when we talked about the pen tool and the node tool. So I will link to those in the description if you want to see more about the pen and the node tool and know more about working with nodes. But what I find this handy for is maybe starting to illustrate something like maybe a sticker. And I can use any one of these shapes to get started. And then I can convert it to curves and I can make some little tweaks to adjust it to look a little bit more like whatever I'm trying to draw. So let's say I'm trying to draw a teddy bear's stomach or something like that. I could take this shape, move it like this, and maybe I want to change the corners and I will take the percentage of it up to make more of an oval for my teddy bear's stomach. And then I could convert it to curves and I could say that, you know, I want it to be a little bit more like this. So that's what I would use convert to curves for. Obviously, there's other things you can do with it, but that's why I would convert a shape to curves so that I could make some more adjustments beyond the ones that you can do with the shape tool. All right, so I hope that was helpful. I'm going to look at some of the other things you can do with the other shapes in a separate video. Thanks for watching.